Welcome back to another amazing episode of Trailer Trashing. I'm your host, Joey Rinaldi, and joining me as they do every Tuesday is Chief Editor Producer Charlie Weinschenk and our local funny man, Derek Blythe.
I'm funny. It's me.
Thanks, Pajama Joe.
And today we're doing part two of our two-part episode, and this is Crime Does Pay.
Crime Does Pay.
And I believe Derek Blythe has a little announcement that he needs to make for everybody.
By the nature of today's theme, you're about to hear many very large spoilers for films, all 20 years or older. But you should be warned, if you are not okay with spoilers, please turn the podcast off now and go watch every movie before that was made before now.
You know what?
I really lost it at the end. I didn't write it down. Please keep your arms and legs inside the podcast at all times. Mucho cuidado, por favor. Mucho spoilers.
This bit has gone on too long. Also, if you don't like spoilers, don't turn the podcast off. Just turn your podcast on mute so we still get the stats of you guys listening.
Just by the nature of, I'm saying it now before we say any movie titles because we realized, I think, early on, like the theme, today's theme, like just by hearing Crime Does Pay and then the title, you know that the criminals get away with it and are directly benefited by their actions.
Yeah, it's like the whole theme of this week and probably also last week's is directly related to the ending of movies.
Which is fun because Trailer Trashing is America's biggest spoiler podcast. We love spoiling.
America's biggest spoiler podcast. Rosebud was the sled. Bruce Willis is dead. Trailer Trashing.
That should be our catchphrase. Guys, I'm really excited for this episode because I have a personal connection to all three movies we're doing, and that never happens on this show. So I'm excited for me to get real personal and with it. So
not even for baseball movies?
Baseball movie was the most personal podcast I've ever done. This is the second most personal podcast I've ever done. So, Charlie, you chose this first movie. Will you introduce it to our lovely listeners? And they are
That's
lovely.
That's right. Yes. This is The Usual Suspects with Kevin Spacey, who
and a ton of other people. Benicio del Toro.
Wait. So, Kevin Spacey, we know, did some bad stuff. And the director of this movie is Bryan Singer, who's also done bad stuff. Like, both of these guys, and the thing is, they were friends. Like they were close friends, these guys. So I'm sketched out by this movie.
Well, you know what the moral of the story is from both of what you, Joey, and you, Derek, are saying is that if you do bad stuff, people remember that you're in a movie and not Benicio del Toro.
But you know who the main character of this movie is? Chaz Palminteri. He's a very good guy. In middle school, I was very good friends with his son. I've been to his house a bunch of times. Chaz is probably one of the most lovely guys I've ever
met. Which one is he? Is he like the cop?
He's the cop. He's the main character. He's the Italian guy.
I hurt my foot from that name you just dropped.
Wow, that was good.
Hey, okay. Before we get too much into this movie, should we watch the trailer?
Yeah.
All right. Let's watch those trailers.
Usually, when there is a crime, there is a motive.
I want to know why 27 men died on that pier for what looks to be $91 million worth of dope that wasn't there.
Usually, when there is a lineup, there's only one real suspect.
This whole thing was a shakedown. And there's no way they'd line five felons in the same room.
But this is not the usual crime. This is not the usual motive.
He was in the harbor killing many men.
Kaiser Soze!
He saw Kaiser Soze.
And these are not the usual suspects. Keaton.
I'm a businessman.
McManus.
There's nothing that can't be done.
Hockney.
What, you got a team of monkeys working around the clock on this?
Fenster.
Flip you for real.
Verbal Kent.
Roger, really. People say I talk too much.
He doesn't know what you want to know.
I don't think he does. Not exactly. But there's a lot more to his story, believe me.
In a world where nothing is what it seems.
The greatest trick the devil ever pulled,
he's here,
was convincing the world.
I know he's here.
He didn't exist.
You've got to look beyond the usual suspects.
I'm smarter than you. And I'm going to find out what I want to know, whether you like it or not.
I work for Kaiser Soze. He feels you owe him. He does not expect all of you to live, but those of you who do will have $91 million.
It was Kaiser Soze, Agent Kuyen. I mean the devil himself.
I'm telling you, it's Kaiser Soze!
There is no Kaiser Soze.
Keaton always said, I don't believe in God, but I'm afraid of him. Well, I believe in God. And the only thing that scares me is Kaiser Soze.
Did I mention I know Chaz Parmentieri?
Ooh, ow.
Yeah, they didn't even say his name.
So, Usual Suspects, that trailer, I'm going to say it was pretty good. There was too much Predator in there, if you know what I mean.
There was too much of the Hungarian guy or whatever, cutting back. I'm telling you, it was Kaiser Soze!
So I don't
every
remember.
Couple minutes.
But I don't remember that character in the movie, and now I'm seeing him in the whole trailer. Was he that important in the trailer and in the actual movie?
There was one, they're like, oh, this guy's burnt up or something, but he only speaks Hungarian. And then they go to the hospital, and he just says Kaiser Soze over and over.
Who is Kaiser Soze? That's the question of the movie.
Yeah. It's like a really, really cool movie, and the way they do their storytelling is very fun and enjoyable. And it's an exhilarating movie, and let's just say crime pays in the end.
Before we get to why crime pays in the end, let's just talk about the trailer for what it was. I think the trailer was actually very good. Like, I love making fun of trailers.
A good trailer.
But I don't have anything to make fun of it. There's nothing for me to shit on. And so I'm going to pull the Roger Ebert flipperoony flip-flopper by saying I think it's actually a bad trailer because I wanted so desperately for something to hate. And since there was actually nothing to hate, I actually hated that trailer because it was actually good.
That's
the most messed up logic I've ever heard in my entire life.
Not even Roger Ebert has gotten
that far. But remember Roger Ebert was like that.
What you were going for.
Remember he
I
was
know
like
what you were going for.
Okay. Well, I tried it. I said it. And the deed's been done. What do you think, Charlie?
I think that it's kind of there's a huge weight on this trailer because this movie. The whole thing is like you're being like teased and like you're being strung along and then boom, they get you with a twist. And the huge amount of weight that's on this trailer is that like I'm watching this trailer knowing what happens in the movie, but it really doesn't give away anything at all. Like, you know, it's like a crime movie, whodunit maybe, like who's this Kaiser Soze guy, and that's about it. It gives you a taste, and that's a good trailer.
Okay, I hear what you're saying, and it sounds like you're saying this. If we took the Soylent Green trailer and replaced the words, what is the secret behind Soylent Green, and replaced it with who is Kaiser Soze, it would have worked. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. Yeah, because it's like they have the weight of the idea, like, you know, just like what you're saying with Soylent Green, like the whole thing is like, what is Soylent Green?
What is the secret behind Soylent Green?
What is the secret?
Yeah, see, the difference is they didn't do that. They didn't go, who is Kaiser Soze? They just like.
Well, I didn't like that voice. Like, that voice you used was very offensive.
It sounded like a little crustacean.
Yeah.
Like a little crab guy. See you on the beach after taking too many mushrooms. Or in a dream.
Here we go. Should we just stop the today's theme and just explore what the fuck Derek's talking about?
the crab. You're waiting on a beach. A beautiful girl is in the distance. There is a pinch on your toe.
It's your
little toe. Hello. I am Francois Le Crab. Who is Kaiser Soze? You wake up, but did you really wake up? Your room is full of crabs. The tube is pouring crabs into your room. There's so many crabs. You wake up again, but do you really? Who is Kaiser Soze?
Who is Kaiser Soze?
Derek, it sounded like you were doing like a guided meditation. You were like, you're on a beach. Who is, like, I don't know. It just sounds
like a reverse guide. It's a guide. It's a guided panic attack.
Yes. Oh, I should do that. Like, join me for my guided panic attack podcast. I can't feel my hands.
So Derek, what did you think of the trailer? And don't be too nice about it either. You show some emotion.
I enjoyed it a lot, and I'm allowing myself to enjoy it. Unlike Joey, I enjoyed it a lot. They just cut to that one guy too much, and then the ending with the water was slow. But also, it's like you get the names and you see how much star power is in this.
Yeah.
I don't think there's any women in this though. So that's a problem.
It doesn't pass the Bechdel test.
I don't think it has any women at all in it.
But it has Chaz Palminteri. Oh, and yeah. I'm looking at his name, and it's got two Z's.
Oh, man, I got to sweep up my room here. There's so many names on the ground. Whoa.
You know, I went to a podcast with the guy who's friends with this guy's son.
Bryan Singer?
No, you, Joey. You doofus.
Oh, because Bryan Singer likes little boys like Kevin Spacey, so I thought that you—that's what you were talking about.
Whoa!
I know Bryan Singer is already canceled, but I want to make sure that Bryan Singer gets canceled because I rewatched all the X-Men movies recently and I hated them so much. And so I just want to go on the record right now. I want to cancel Bryan Singer. Let's move on to the podcast.
You didn't like the X-Men movies?
He's a bad guy, okay?
It sounded like it was totally unrelated.
So I'm on the right side of history on this, Charlie. So I'm gonna give the trailer an 8. What do you guys give it?
I give it an eight. It's a good trailer.
Yep.
That sounds 8. Like high for what you said about it, Joey.
I was being ridiculous to be ridiculous. It happens, okay? It's what the fans want. It's what the trash heads are looking for.
Yeah, so why does crime pay? Oh, did I suggest this movie? I'll explain. What do we want to do? Do we give away the ending?
Spoil it! Spoil it! Spoil it!
Spoiled trash.
Yeah, I mean, essentially, the reason why this is a crime does pay movie is because you got these usual suspects, and
they're very usual.
Yeah, because they get rounded up. They're like these career criminals that like always are getting taken into custody, but this time they're working together, and they're all in on the crime. And you got Kevin Spacey, who's like essentially
verbal Kent.
Yeah, he's non-threatening. Like, they're like, this is some guy who does the books. You know, we just want to get some information. And he starts spilling the guts. You know, spilling his guts. He's like, oh, it's Kaiser Soze. He's so scary. And
it's the name Verbal.
Yeah. Exactly. Exactly. So, yeah. So
exactly.
Exactamundo.
Correctamundo.
Exactamiissimo.
I don't know Spanish.
Exacto knife. So
Expecto
they,
Patronum.
they
Wingardium Leviosa. I'm sorry, Charlie. Finish this point.
You bastards. Essentially, they play the police by the police don't think that they're all in cahoots as much as they are, and they all spin this story about Kaiser Soze and how he's behind this whole crime when it was really all of them, and the mastermind was the least of the suspected suspects, and I won't say who it was.
It was Kevin Spacey, the really bad guy. He's a bad guy in movies. He's a bad guy in real life. I want him out of this podcast. I want him out on the streets. I want him in a jail cell.
Oh, shit. I just remembered a fun fact that I think I'm about to steal from Joey.
Give it to me.
There's a the iconic like image in this is them all being lined up in the police lineup, and they're kind of laughing casually like they know something. But the reason why the laugh is so good is because during that take, Benicio del Toro farts very loudly and obviously, and they're all laughing about it.
You know that's what?
Did I steal? Was that one of your facts you wrote down?
That was the big fun fact. That was like the big.
I stole it from you.
I you know what?
It's my house now. I am the captain. Soy el capitán.
You know what, Derek? Crime doesn't pay, because I'm going to get you back for this.
Better have a really good freaking fact and fast, or you're out of here. You'll never work in podcasting again.
In college, me and my friends tried to do a whole crime does pay, like string along the police kind of situation like this. Because one time I broke a bottle outside the dorms, and someone called the police on me, and we all were gonna like go in and spin this whole story, but then everyone was like, "Nope, it was Charlie. Charlie broke the bottle," and then I got in trouble.
Oh, you did a crime just to see if you could get away with it?
Nope, I was being rowdy.
I was gonna say, what are you, Sharon Stone in Basic Instinct?
Are you saying you have more stuff in common with Bryan Singer and Kevin Spacey than you have with us?
No, whoa. Not at all. Oh,
whoa, whoa! With
get
the character,
out of here with that
the
stuff.
Character assassination here.
Okay, you know what?
Broken bottles,
Derek. I'm mad you stole my fun fact because my other fun
stole
fact
your fun fart fact. I'm the king of fart facts.
Because my other fun fact was going to be a compliment to you, Derek, and now I don't know if I want to compliment you.
Oh shit!
I'll do it anyways, but I want you to because it will hurt your feelings. The fact that I was complimenting you after you stole something from me.
Oh.
All right. So John Ottman, who edited this movie, also composed this movie, which is very rare. And I was thinking to myself, if there's any
soundtrack?
Yeah. And I was thinking to myself, if there's any man I know who could edit a movie and compose the movie, it's Derek Blythe. But now I don't know if I feel that way anymore.
Thanks for the plug. I'm available for work, guys. You need a podcast theme? I think I've done a couple.
You've done at least one.
I've done a couple. I've edited some stuff. I did a song about a hot dog once, probably. Please help. It's a pandemic. I really need work. And I can do stuff. And I know fart facts.
So, fart facts. You know, and you know fun lemur facts, too.
Oh, yeah. They have stink fights.
Yeah, wow. Which is fart related. So, yep.
Glandular.
So I can tell the people listening are dying to get to the Rotten Tomato game, so I'm going to spare them right now by moving on. Rotten Tomato time, baby. What do you guys think?
Who goes first?
I believe Charlie still sucks and is losing at this game. So you're like in a hole. I think like you're losing like 30 episodes to 5. I think like Derek has beaten you 30 times. So
woe is me, you know? So does that mean I go first or second?
You choose. Do you want to go first or second, Charlie?
I'll go second.
Derek?
I'll go first. I think this is pretty high, like an 85.
Derek? I mean, Charlie?
I also think this is pretty high, so I'll go 87.
Wow. For the first time, Charlie did the right thing in a long time. It was
That's
an 89.
Right.
It's so messed up how you talk to this boy. How dare you come at us and be like, you guys aren't nice to me. And then you just spew your vitriol all over our souls.
Yeah.
Then you play your victim card when we snap back.
Mutilate my
shame
soul.
Shame on you. A fart on your family.
Sorry I host this show. And when you host the show, you got to put people in their place. And sometimes, Charlie specifically, when we were playing the Rotten Tomato game, you really got to show him who's boss. Especially when Charlie sucks so hard at that game. But you know what, Charlie? You won the first round today, so congrats.
That's right. I rock. I rock. I don't suck. I rock. If anyone sucks, it's Derek.
Whoa.
Yes. Yes. Derek. See, this is what I do. I team up with Charlie now. Now we're going against Derek. This is fun.
I'm just high on all of the winning I just did.
High on your fart fumes, booger ass nerd.
Hey. Keep your bodily fluids out of this. And let's get to my favorite part of the show. Mr. Bobby Jr. Seeger III.
Oh, he hated it.
Oh, no.
He gave it a 1.5 stars on August 18th, 1995.
You know what? Ebert's on the right side of history here. He's going against two bad people.
No, he's rating a movie.
No. His first line is, fuck Bryan Singer and fuck Kevin Spacey. That's his first line.
It's true. It's a very incendiary review. It says very... A lot of fucks. It's like a picture he drew of him castrating Bryan Singer. Yeah, this is crazy, Bobby Hebert.
It's only like a handful of paragraphs. It's really short, so he really didn't like it, I guess. Okay, the interrogation between the cop and the suspect falls into a monotonous pattern. Friendliness, testiness, hostility.
Hostility.
A big blow-up, threats, reconciliations, and then the full circle again. We hear amazing stories about Soze. One survivor of the boat explosion with burns over most of his body drifts in and out of a coma but can talk of no one else. As verbal talks, we see that what he describes, and his story takes on an objective quality in our minds. We forget we're only getting his version. To the degree that you will want to see this movie, it will be because of the surprise. And I will say no more, except that the solution, quotes, when it comes, solves little, unless there is really little to solve, which is also a possibility. Wow, yeah, didn't do it for him.
I forgot that this was one of those unreliable narrator movies.
Oh, yeah, well, because it basically subverts you the entire time, and then boom, at the end with the twist. So
at
it's
the end,
like,
you're like, wow, I couldn't, you know, is any of that to be believed? Or was it all shit that he saw on the wall?
Yeah, and it's also like, it's an unreliable narrator because, like, you have no ability to think that, like, something else is going on. You know what I mean? They don't give you room to think. That's why the twist hits so hard. I guess not for him, not for Kaiser Ebert. But
I wish it would cut to him like doing the voices, because this is like the number one on a long line of list on a long list of movies where I can't understand a single thing Benicio del Toro says. This is like the top.
So, a little casting what if. Chaz Palminteri was originally supposed to be, his character was supposed to be played by Al Pacino. And I speak for everybody on this pod. And I speak for everybody on this podcast. We're happy that they chose Chaz over Al Pacino. Because
fast forward to today, Joey wouldn't have been able to like talk about how cool he is for playing that guy.
Exactly.
Al Pacino.
But I know Chaz Palminteri,
and he's got two Z's. It's Chaz with two Z's.
Two Z's.
Oh, it's probably has a crazy long. It's short for something crazy long in Italian.
Calogero.
Chazione.
No,
manata.
It's
Palminteri. Ri.
In his famous movie A Bronx Tale, he explains that his name's Calogero, and they shorten it to C.
I don't believe you.
It's a famous movie, and it's a one-man show. You. Dude, it's actually an amazing one-man show. If he ever does it again, I would recommend checking out
Bronx Tale. Is a one-man show?
Yeah, that's how it was originally. Chaz Palminteri's one-man show.
I saw that he just did that, right? Last year or something?
Yeah, he still does it, like, regularly. I've seen it live. It's awesome.
On Zoom?
Are you making fun of me for doing a one-man show on Zoom last night? Is that what this is about?
No. Okay. But now's your time to plug it.
No,
yeah,
I'm not.
Plug it up. Plug it. Joey's doing a one-man show on Zoom.
It's a good show. It's very funny. I directed it. Look out for it. Follow him.
There were folding chairs involved in the process, I hear. But that's for like the behind
the scenes.
Okay. A couple sandwiches, too.
You know what? I can talk all day about how, for a short time in my life, I knew Chaz Palminteri. let's move on to the next trailer that Derek chose, which Derek says I will actually really like. Why is that, Derek?
Because it's got that TNA and V.
Yep. There's a little bit of vagina
B.
in this one.
So let's...
And MD, that's Michael Douglas. And you see his butt a lot. I knew you'd be into that.
A dude butt?
Yeah, MDB? Michael Douglas butt.
Are you talking about some MDB?
Yeah, some full-on, unadulterated MDB. And a lot of it.
So let's get to the MDB.
We got 31 stab wounds.
What was it?
Ice pick.
I'd like to speak to a Miss Catherine Trammell, please.
Is she a suspect?
She's a suspect.
I wanted to write a book about the murder of a retired rock and roll star.
You know how she does the boyfriend? With an ice pick.
She intended the book to be her alibi. I picked him up, then I had sex with him.
You didn't feel anything for him, you just had sex with him for your book.
In the beginning. Then I got to like what he did for me.
You like playing games, don't you?
It's nice.
You've got no physical evidence.
She's lying. What's your new book about?
A detective who falls for the wrong woman.
What happens?
She kills him.
Stay away from her! You are out of control, Kurt!
You won't learn anything I don't want you to know.
She knew I'd say she did it, and she knew that nobody would buy it. She is screwing with your head, Nick!
She knows things about me that I only told you.
How does it feel to kill someone?
You tell me.
Wasn't it?
She manipulates people.
Freeze!
How much did she pay you?
Come on! You better play that! Come on!
She knows where I live and breathe.
Games are over, Nick.
Hot.
Ooh, I need a cigarette.
Hot diggity dog. That is the hottest, most sensual, sexiest movie trailer I've ever seen on Trailer Trashing. And if you are listening to this, do yourself a favor. Go on YouTube right now. Pull that trailer up. Light an incense candle and really enjoy yourself.
It was fast-paced action and lots of sex appeal.
If I remember correctly, the movie just basically just starts on a crazy sex scene. Woo. Like, it starts with full-on
like Bridesmaids.
Pornog. Yeah.
Do you know what I'm talking about, though, with Bridesmaids?
Yeah.
I had a free period in high school, and me and my friend decided to watch Bridesmaids, and, like, we just watched it out loud on his computer, and people literally just thought we were watching porn in the library.
So, I got a fun fact that I think I got to jump into immediately.
Are you afraid that I'll snatch him up from you?
Yeah, so... So, the director, Paul Verhoeven, I don't know how to say his name. He's actually a legend because he directed Total Recall, which has the famous three-breasted woman. And so he knows a lot about sensual stuff. So
Szechuan.
Szechuan sauce. He knows a lot about Szechuan sauce.
Szechuan chicken.
And so, so when the rough cut of this movie got made, the MPAA was like, this is NC-17. There's no way you can put this movie in movie theaters. And he went to their office, not once, not twice, but 8 times to argue with them why it should be rated R and not NC-17. And you know how he got them to make it a rated R movie? He says that the sex scenes in this movie are not sex scenes because we're just showing sex. They're showing a thriller aspect, and it's building the plot. And like he somehow like used that to like justify it being rated R.
Should we look at the Christian mom reviews then on this one?
That would be
really fun.
Cool.
Kid reviews, 5 stars from 13-year-old Kevin.
Wait, let me.
Not a movie to watch with your parents. It's so uncomfortable. If you,
oh
do.
Yeah, yeah,
I didn't.
I've had my fair share of those kinds of experiences.
Oh wait, I found it.
Please link it. It's probably so good.
Have you guys seen Don't Fuck with Cats on Netflix?
I've seen the thumbnail for it, and I thought the title was really weird, and I didn't like the title.
Yeah, bad title for sure, but it's totally related to this movie, actually. Like, it's completely related, and here's why. It's about this guy who posted a video of him murdering a kitten on the internet, and then people went crazy, and then he started like murdering more and more cats on the internet, and people were like freaking out, and it was always the same guy. And then he started murdering people, and he started leaving this trail. And as it turns out, he was just trying to like do a whole, he was pulling a Basic Instinct to the point where when he got arrested, he did the open and close leg thing in the police. Like they showed it, like he like asked
for
a cigarette.
Ew, with the dingus?
No, he just opened and closed his legs.
You don't even fully see her yowza. You see her basically just her mom's pubis. Yeah. She goes, it's actually a great clip. Like, there's so many bits that are great in that just like 3 seconds of moot. Because Newman is like interrogating her, and Newman is like sweating more than he did. He's like sweating more than he did when he got killed by that dinosaur in the dinosaur movie. And yeah. she looks at Michael Douglas and she's like, have you ever fucked someone on cocaine? And then she does the leg thing, and then she's like, well, I have, or whatever she says. But it's a great
And that was the Derek Butcher the Scene Hour. Join us next time.
Stab, stab, stab. Scene butchered. If anything, I made it better.
Yeah, it's true. That was way more sexy than the original scene.
I'm glad you brought up that other movie, because this movie is on, like, if you Google like good portrayals of clinical psychopaths in movies, this is on like most all the lists, because she's if you don't know, like, psychopaths, their brain is messed up where they don't have the capacity for empathy for anyone. So they get bored, and the very, very clever ones, they'll either become like millionaires and ruin the world, or they'll, you know, be like her and prey on people and use them to write books and get away with stuff and have crime pay because you're so clever and you just don't care.
And that brings us to our theme. Why does crime pay, boys?
Oh, Derek, it's your turn.
Oh, did anyone else see this?
I've never seen it, but I'm going to watch it the second this podcast ends.
It's good. It's not like, I don't know. I don't know if it's a masterpiece. It's kind of long, but it is a really good portrayal. Like, I think I'm really interested by psychopaths, and it displays it very well. She gets away with it. She gets away with all her murders, and they become parts of her, like, best-selling novels. Like, she writes them before they happen, and just to see if she can make it play out. And then it pays off, because, you know, she very clearly does the murder at the beginning, and you don't really see her, but you kind of have no doubt in your mind, because it's like, oh, it's her book. And then she targets her detective that's investigating her, Michael Douglas, for a book about girl that kills a detective investigating her in the sack. And then, like, over the course of it, like,
she, I can get behind that
in the sack. And she like successfully over time, like, seduces him. And then while he's getting seduced, you know, you as a viewer start to have doubts about her as well, because she's just so ridiculously sexy in
it. So spoil the movie. Why does crime pay?
It pays off because she gets away with it, and she gets a ton of money from her exes who are dead. Everyone who gets close to her who is mildly interesting ends up dying. So she fulfills her like desires to get away with these crimes, and also gets like her book revenue and stuff.
Well, let's talk about the real crime Sharon Stone committed, breaking my achy breaky heart. Damn, she's a cold fox.
Did you write this child review? Kid 9 years old. This just, and it says,
lots of racing material.
I'm 9 and this movie is for someone twice my age. I had never seen those parts of a lady before. Yowza! The story is kind of good, though.
5 stars.
That's 9-year old Joey.
That's exactly what we were looking for.
I've never seen a Mons pubis before.
Before we get to our babyface Eber extraordinaire, let's please play the tomato game. Derek, I'm really pulling for you. I hate when Charlie wins. I'll let Charlie go first this time.
This movie is a classic. I was going to say, I haven't seen it either, but it's just so classic. I just know it, like, all the stuff about it. So if it's that classic, it's got to be good. So I'm going to go 87 again.
Derek, how would you counter?
I think it probably is high, but I don't remember it being like reviewed well at the time. So I don't think it's that high. It's probably closer to like,
you're
what do you
so
say, 87?
You're so close, Derek. Just come on. You're so close.
It's probably like...
You're leading the witness.
It's probably like somewhere closer to like a 75 or 78 or something.
Yeah, Derek wins. Fuck you, Charlie. It was a 52.
52?
Why did you even say that he was so close?
Because he was going...
So close to winning.
He was going below you. He was going below...
Why did it do so bad? They didn't like the Mons Pubis?
Do you want me to read what the Tomato people said?
Yeah, sure. But also, Sharon Stone married Ellen DeGeneres, right?
Mm-mm. You're thinking... Oh, she might have in the 90s. I don't know. But wait, are you talking about who she's married to right now?
I don't know.
Or
I don't know
she's
anymore.
She's married to the girl from Arrested Development now. Portia de Rossi.
Oh, really? Yeah, she was definitely married to Ellen DeGeneres.
Wait,
then,
Sharon Stone's a lesbian? Because
she kind of is in this movie a little bit.
Wait, because that's...
a sexual predator.
Wait a second. That's wild because I have a fun fact about Sharon Stone not being... like doing some straight stuff.
You're allowed to have sex with whoever you want if you're an adult and there's consent.
Yeah, Joey.
So the
get out of here.
Before we get to Roger Ebert, I have to go down a few fun facts because all these fun facts all link together to a great fun fact. Can I have the floor? I have the floor. I'm taking the floor. The writer
you
of this
got the floor.
Take your floor full of drop names.
All right, the writer of this movie, his name is Joe. You know how to say his name? Exterhaz? Exterhaz. Exterhaz. Yeah. So anyways, Joe Exterhaz. It's kind of funny. This guy, he wrote like a lot of like chick flicks. Not chick flicks, but like movies about chicks. He wrote like this movie, Flashdancers, a bunch of other stuff with girls in it. And it's funny because he's like an old like big, like burly looking like Breaking Bad character, like the type of guy that would know nothing about women ever, but like this guy, he knows about the ladies, he writes about the ladies, and he
knows they have a Mons Pubis.
In an interview in 2001, he casually mentioned, oh yeah, I had sex with Sharon Stone, and I'm glad it happened, because in a weird way, it led to me meeting my wife. And listen to how crazy this story is. After she had sex with him, she left him to have sex with a Hollywood producer who was married. The Hollywood producer leaves his wife for Sharon Stone, and when he leaves his wife, the writer, Joe Hazerstein, or whatever his name is, he picks up the Hollywood producer's ex-wife. Isn't that a crazy...
Oh, that's a swaparoony. What's it like? Eric Clapton and George Harrison or whoever. One of the Beatles.
Layla, you got me on my... Yeah, that song.
Right.
Was that fun fact?
We all know how that one ends, though, am I right?
She got me on my knees.
Oh, I was going to say the kid
I'm begging, darling,
the window.
Please.
Wait, also, do you guys know the cigarette by any chance? Basic cigarette?
Nope.
There's a cigarette. I swear to God, it's called Basic Cigarettes. Their slogan is, the best thing in life are basic. Keep it basic. Which is the worst catchphrase ever. And I guess like the
keep
cigarette.
Keep it basic. No alarms and no surprises.
So I'm pretty, based on my half-assed research that is probably wrong, this cigarette was going to go out of business. But then when Basic Instincts came out, they made like a whole ad campaign around Basic Instinct. And it like resurged the cigarette for like a year.
A year. Huh. Nice. One more year. We got him, boys.
Which that's kind of fucked up because one of the things in the movie is Michael Douglas is trying really hard to quit smoking and other vices. And one of the ways she controls him is she gets him back on drinking and booze and stuff. So it's pretty messed up to like market a cigarette based off of that aspect.
Yeah.
It's really messed up.
What's even more messed up is that Joe Exterhaz got throat cancer.
Different every time. Let's hear it again.
Joe Exterhaz.
Okay.
I don't know.
Now you're trying.
He got throat cancer from cigarettes, and he said he regrets making this movie because it promotes cigarettes.
Which I'm glad you brought up because there are cunnilingus scenes with Michael Douglas, and if anyone remembers,
Yes, he got
Michael
throat cancer.
Michael Douglas got throat cancer, and he blamed it on cunnilingusing Angelina Jolie so much.
Really?
And how does that work? Reminded me, like, it doesn't. He's just like bragging. He beat throat cancer, and he said, "I got it from eating too much Mons Pubis." And then, I don't remember the last time I watched this, but I remember like there are cunnilingus scenes, and I just remember now like what a slow. I remember that being on all of the like late night talk show jokes. Like everyone had jokes about that, and it reminded me of a simpler time in our history where we'd do like one news story would circulate all the Jay Leno, Conan O'Brien stuff for 2 months or whatever. It would be like Martha Stewart went to jail and that would be all we talked about. And now the news is just like every 2 seconds, there's a new horrible thing.
So speaking of horrible things, listen to this horrible review that Ebert gave Basic
Two
Instinct.
Stars.
Two stars!
2 stars. 1992 did better than the other one. But I'm going to read the first paragraph because I think it's pretty interesting.
Wait, time out. Did we not give the rating of the trailer? We fucked up.
Oh, that was a good trailer. I give it a 9.
Trailer's fine.
Yeah, I give it a 10 out of 10.
It's an exciting trailer.
I'll give it an 8.
I'm giving it a 10 out of 10 because those scenes with Sharon Stone were too smooth. Okay, take it away, Charlie.
Yeah, I'm going to first read the first paragraph because it's really dated because it's from 1992, so I really don't understand. I wasn't here for this. I don't know what it's talking about, but it says, in their protest against Paul Verhoeven's Basic Instinct, gay activists have been giving away the ending of the movie. With some thrillers, that would be a damaging blow, but the ending of Basic Instinct is so arbitrary that it hardly matters. This is not a movie where the outcome depends on the personality or behavior of the characters. It's just a wind-up machine to jerk us around.
Just jerk me around. Yeah, because she has a... I don't know. I could see them protesting. That's not really the point of the movie.
What would the protest be?
She has more than one, like, lesbian lover, and the one gets, like, so jealous of Michael Douglas that she, like, does, like, a car fight with him and drives off the bridge. You know car fights?
Yeah, oh, yeah.
You know car fights? She does a car fight with him and dies while flying off a bridge, but, like, Sharon Stone throughout the movie is like, oh, she was obsessed with me. And so she gets these people to obsess over her, and that's kind of part of the psychopathy.
But what's the protest? They're protesting.
I don't know. It could be, if you interpret the movie as her being a manipulative gay person, then maybe. But I think she's just also
stop making gay people manipulative in the movies.
But like everyone, male and female, obsesses over her, and then even you do as you watch the movie, and that's kind of
the point.
I know
I do. I just saw the trailer and I'm obsessing over her.
It's like try to not get a boner while the freaking like club dance scene happens. It's impossible.
Derek's like, I've tried. I've seen this movie in many different ways.
Don't
never
get a
taught.
Boner. Do the Basic Instinct. Don't get a boner challenge.
Okay.
I think I want to read the last paragraph too. Is that all right, or do we not have time?
We don't have time, and I also need a cut to the next movie because this is the most exciting movie that we're ever going to do on this podcast. It's my favorite comedy of all time, and it's a great example of how crime does, in fact, pay. It is the classic Steve Zahn, Jason Biggs, Jack Black, Neil Diamond, Amanda Peet movie, Saving Silverman.
It's probably the only movie with all of those people in it at once.
All the big hitters of the early 2000s.
Let's just get to the movie, and we're all going to see why this movie is out of this world incredible.
Roll that beautiful bean footage.
This story is about me and my two pals. We've been best friends since the fifth grade. Yes! But now we're all grown up. Nothing could ever come between us. Then she came along.
Give the lady a scotch, and I'll have another beer.
Oh, he'll have a gin and tonic.
Make that a gin and tonic.
Judy, awesome to meet you.
Judith.
And a beer bong for the lady.
Darren tells me you're a psychologist. I'm in a related field.
Really? What's that?
Pest and rodent removal.
I don't want you to see Wayne or Jay
JD ever again, Darren.
I'm not dropping Wayne and JD.
Okay, fine. No more sex. No fun.
From the director of Big Daddy.
We miss you. We never see you anymore.
Comes a story about tough love.
Judith proposed to me.
Darren's my puppet and I'm his puppet master.
Before Judith, our fun level was at an all-time high, 93. But look now.
Two good friends.
Who's Darren talking to?
Those are his new friends.
We're not giving up on Darren. Coming out, yeah!
And bad ideas.
We're gonna kidnap Judith and set Darren up with Sandy.
Yeah!
What?
Darren?
Sandy?
Sandy?
The bat is leaving the cave.
I'm hit. I need backup.
I just can't figure out why Judith left. Maybe she got kidnapped. You think? No, definitely not. That's impossible.
She got the way to move my chair.
Jason Biggs.
Oh, there's the duck. That was always Judith's favorite.
Sorry. Steve Zahn.
If you say anything about Judith, I'll give you a little shock.
Ow!
Okay.
Jack Black.
Have you ever had a girlfriend?
Yes.
Amanda Pete.
Oh,
we're on a mission of love.
Yeah.
I love you, Judith.
Oh. Judith!
Sadie Silverman.
Judith escaped.
Durr.
She got the red movement chair.
Alright.
Yo, that movie trailer was the bombdiggity.com. Go tell your grandma, tell your mom, tell your neighbors. This is the movie trailer of the year. I have nothing to trash. I just have stuff to praise. It's beautiful. Praise Allah. Praise God.
That's pretty good.
That's fine.
It was all right.
Really? Nothing?
Yeah, it's fine. Nah.
I remember the movie being good. It came on like every 5 minutes in the early 2000s on Comedy Central.
Yeah, when you suggested this, I was like, I must have seen
this.
Yeah,
I've seen it
probably
a lot of
times. I
think I
watched it with my dad.
Did you not like the part when he said, coming to Yeha?
No, I like that part. That was good.
That's pretty good.
I'm a fan of Jack Black. No, how could you not like Jack Black?
Pretty good made-up word.
Yeah. It's not a made-up word. It's a made-up religion.
Oh.
It's my philosophy. Like whenever
I didn't get that from the trailer.
Well, because you're not...
It wasn't in the trailer, Joey.
I hate you guys so much.
Can we just, like... I'm going to go do a pee and just let Joey talk for 10 minutes about the movie.
Don't go anywhere, Derek.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Don't go anywhere because this is Joey's cool fanboy rant time.
Well, this isn't a fanboy. I want to know. This isn't a fanboy rant. This is why crime pays in this movie.
But also, let's not forget to rate that trailer, boys.
I give it a 6.
Yeah, I'll give it a 5. It's very middle of the road comedy trailer.
You guys are such assholes. I feel like
this is not to spite you.
I feel like Michael
it was
Scott.
Fine.
It was fine. Yeah, there's nothing wrong with it.
I know how Michael Scott feels every time Toby talks because this is what you guys are doing to me right now. You guys are Toby.
I can't
me.
Believe you. That's fucked up what you said.
It's fucked up what you guys are doing.
I
to
expect
me right
an
now.
Apology and immediate resignation by morning, or I will.
Okay. I'm giving it a 9.5. The only reason I'm not giving it a 10 is because I didn't like the music they were playing in the intro. That was weird music in the beginning. So it's a 9.5. And let me explain why this movie is crime pays. Because I know what you're thinking. You want to think like an action movie when we say crime pays. This is not really an action movie. It's a comedy.
Well, I would just say that it's...
Let me explain why crime pays, Charlie.
I don't think any of these are action movies either.
Okay.
Yeah,
well,
it's not about action. It's just about like their crime movies, and this has nothing
like
really
two
to do
thrillers
with crime.
And a comedy.
So I'm gonna explain. I'm gonna explain why this is a crime pays movie. Steve Zahn and Jack Black. What they do is they kidnap a woman. The woman they kidnap is their best friend's girlfriend because she's a bad girlfriend. So they kidnap her so their best friend can meet a different girl. And then while they're kidnapping her, they realize they also need to kidnap Neil Diamond because they can get Neil Diamond to tell their friend that he needs to stop worrying about the girl, then it would work. So they kidnap two people, and they should go to jail. They actually do go to jail in this movie. They get arrested, and then they break out of jail. So that's three crimes. They kidnap two people, and they break out of jail. So three crimes, and at the end of the movie, it all works out because the girl they kidnap ends up wants to marry one of the guys that kidnapped her. Stockholm Syndrome, classic. Then Jack Black, he realizes he's gay during this movie, and so the coach who breaks them out of jail marries him. And then Neil Diamond is so happy that everybody is falling in love that he officiates their wedding. So crime pays in this movie. Boom.
I see.
So crime pays in the way that they learn to accept themselves and become actualized.
I couldn't say it better myself.
Well, is that they never get actually taken back to prison and no one presses charges.
It's beautiful.
Yeah, crime pays. The crime has paid. I guess the only thing left to do is to test it out in real life.
Okay.
Where is what nursing home is Neil Diamond in now?
But also, what friend do we have has a girlfriend we don't like? That's the better question.
I'm sure we all have one.
Okay. After the podcast, we'll discuss. fun fact about Neil Diamond. Neil Diamond loves this movie. How much does he love this movie? He wrote a song about this movie called The Ballad of Saving Silverman. And he wrote it while they were making this movie in 2001. But the director didn't have like anything. He couldn't use the song for anything. So Neil Diamond kept it in his back pocket and he released it in 2018.
Whoa.
He released a song about
a
movie.
Listen to that.
That's pretty wild.
It is pretty wild.
Come to America.
So we're all tied up in the Rotten Tomato game. So this is for all the marbles to see Bobby Seger live in concert with Roger Ebert's dead corpse.
So who goes first then? I guess that would make Derek go first.
Derek,
you went first. Wait, no. Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
Derek, that's go right. First.
I'll
don't blow
say
this.
It's like a 48. Don't kill me, Joey, please. I'm just trying to win, objectively.
I really think it did worse than that, to be honest with you. But I'm a little afraid to go below that.
Come on, Charlie.
I'm going to go 38.
That was the right move. It was an 18. Rotten Tomatoes.
Oh, my.
They hated this movie. They hated this movie so much.
But what does that mean, everybody? I just won. That's right. I won. Derek, you suck. Joey, you also suck.
Wait, how do I suck? I was pulling for you the whole time, buddy.
No, you weren't. You literally said I hate when Charlie wins. And
no,
guess what?
No.
Yeah, you really stuck it to him.
No.
You really stuck it to him a lot today.
No. Yeah. I'm on Team Charlie.
Get out of here, Joey.
I love Charlie.
You're a nobody. You don't know who I am.
You fucking nobody. Who cares if you know Chaz? Pajamas.
He was a good actor. He had a good one-man show. He inspired me to do my one-man show. And he's a nice guy.
Yeah. Get out of here.
He makes good pancakes.
He actually made me, this is a true story. He made me.
He didn't make you no pancakes.
Close. He made me a breakfast pizza once, which is.
You want a breakfast pizza? It's got eggs, sausage, cheese. It's on a pancake. It's not on a real. Yeah, I'll make you a breakfast pizza. Hey, you drink coffee? You're really scarfing down your breakfast pizza. Hey, it's weird that you're still here when my son's not here.
We're almost out of time. Can we please get to Babyface?
Okay.
The eagle himself, Ebert.
All right, he gave this a half a star in 2001.
And you have to read the first paragraph. The first paragraph is.
I will. I just want to say though that I thought that at least The Usual Suspects and Basic Instincts would be like kind of like on the hard hitting kind of side. At least The Usual Suspects, you know, with the twist. But like these movies all did poorly on Roger Ebert's scale. Nothing got higher than a 2.
Roger Ebert hates when crime pays.
We really picked some winners this time. I'm sure he loved Ocean's 11 and they all got away with it, but no. We're not doing heists.
Did we do crime pays?
Mons Pubis, and we're doing all the others.
Wait, we did. All right. Wait, we did Crime Pays, and none of us chose an Ocean's movie. I just realized how stupid.
Yeah,
that is.
Or a heist, like Italian Job, anything. No heist movies.
We really fucked. We really fucked this up.
They all pay metaphorically almost.
But we also could have done that heist movie with the magicians too. That's a heist movie.
Oh God, now you see it.
Yeah.
What about Hot Rod? Does Crime Pay in that movie? I don't know.
Hot Rod doesn't do crime. Samberg,
there's no crime.
He does a fundraiser.
Making that movie was a crime, if that's what you... No, I actually love that movie.
I love that
yes,
movie.
It's fine. Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that movie, you bastard. All right, Saving Silverman is so bad in so many different ways that perhaps you should see it as an example of the lowest slopes of the bell-shaped curve. This is the kind of movie that gives even its defenders fits of desperation.
I disagree with you, Ebert. I defend it, and I don't... Get, and it's not hard. It's very easy to defend. You have Jack Black, Steve Zahn, Amanda Peet, all great people that I love. Coach is hilarious. Coach has this great speech that is so funny in the movie. You gotta watch the movie. Fuck Ebert. Fuck you,
Roger
Ebert. I think
we've all seen this movie.
Fuck you. We realize crime does pay. For the. I don't know. I give up. I'm losing.
Crime
it.
Pays. Yeah,
it
crime
pays
sometimes.
It paid for verbal Kint. It paid for Catherine Tremell, and it paid for whatever the people's. It paid for Neil Diamond. And it paid for Chaz's Parcinelli's breakfast pizzas.
And that's I think right. That is all for today's episode edition of Crime Pays. We learned a lot of fun stuff. We learned that Joey knows Chaz Palminteri once upon a time. We learn that Basic Instinct is the hottest trailer out there. And we also learn that Neil Diamond has a song about Saving Silverman. Thank you guys so much for listening. I was Joey Rinaldi. That was Derek Blythe and Charlie Weinchink. We'll be back next Tuesday. And if you liked the episode, give us a 5-star review on the podcast app. Or follow us on Instagram. Message me. Keep me company. I'm quarantining. I'm lonely. I'm depressed. Give us some fan mail. And have a great week, guys. We'll see you next week, knuckleheads.
Goodbye.
Breakfast pizza.